In this Warmaster battle report, the forces of the Dark Elves will take on the Dogs of War, and me and Steve will use our tournament armies from the recent London Grand Tournament. The battlefield is set up to represent a fertile Tilean river valley. The game will be played down the length of the board, with the Dark Elves setting up behind the river, with their army representing a raiding force that has sailed inland from the coast, looking for slaves and plunder. While the Tilean army will set up amongst the hills, and they represent the forces of a local merchant prince who has deployed his mercenaries from his castle to defend his subjects. The many hills are open ground and provide defended status for infantry and artillery. The single wood can only be entered by infantry, it counts as dense terrain and provides defended status. The three fields can't be entered by artillery and they prevent charging units from claiming their charge bonus. The four buildings will be impassable. The two ponds are designated as deep water features and are also impassable. The river is designated as a shallow water feature, so can be crossed by all units except for artillery. And the roads are open ground and give a command bonus to units which travel along them in column. The two armies will be fighting over four objectives, which will be placed in the central portion of the map. Each objective is placed next to a building, representing the location of treasure or slaves. At the end of each player's active turn, a unit which controls an objective and has no enemies within 5 centimeters will score 1 point. Once a player reaches 10 points, they win the game. The game will also end if one player breaks his opponent, which will score him 4 points. If that's the case, then the player with the most points wins. The first army is the Dogs of War. My Dogs of War army is General Dutch Schaefer's infamous mercenary band, and they feature several regiments of renown. It has a lot of light infantry, with ogres for heavy infantry, knights for hammer unit, light cavalry for harassment, cannon and birdmen. We start by picking one general. We also have to take 4 units of pikes and 4 units of crossbows. We add 4 units of swordsmen, 2 units of ogres, 2 units of knights, 2 units of light cavalry, 2 galloper guns, and a unit of birdmen. We take a paymaster mounted on his pay wagon. We also take a hero mounted on a griffin with the sword of might, and 2 wizards. We equip the general with the scepter of sovereignty to avoid any blunders, and the army is ready for battle. Next, we look at the Dark Elves. The Dark Elf army features minimum core infantry choices, some witch elves, some dark riders, and a massive strike force of cold white knights. Harpies and characters provide support and command. We must take 1 general, 4 units of spearmen, and 2 units of crossbowmen. We add 2 units of witch elves to provide infantry punch, 6 units of cold one knights as the hammer units of the army, a unit of dark riders for harassment, and 2 units of harpies as flyers. We add a hero mounted on a manticore with the sword of might, and a sorceress with a dispel scroll. The general is equipped with the scepter of sovereignty to prevent blunders and subordinates turning traitor on him, and the army's ready for battle. The Dark Elves begin by placing 1 unit of flying harpies on their left flank, with a second unit of harpies on the right, accompanied by their flying character and the Dark Riders. With a clear mobility advantage, the Dark Elf scouts can be used to claim or contest the early objectives. The Dogs of War deploy their army in 2 lines, with the infantry occupying the defendable hill terrain. Galloper guns and missile infantry occupy the centre, with cavalry and heavier infantry on the wings. The flyers are placed at the rear of the army, with characters interspersed between units to issue commands. The Dogs of War plan to use their mobile elements to capture objectives quickly and slow down the enemy cavalry. The Dark Elves deploy their first heavy infantry brigade on their left flank, accompanied by the Sorceress. The infantry brigades occupy the centre of the army, commanded by the General, whilst the 2nd Heavy Cavalry Brigade occupies the right flank, commanded by the Flying Hero. The Dark Elf army has the clear advantage in mobility and hitting power. If they can capture the objectives first, the Dogs of War will be hard-pressed to dislodge them. Therefore, the Dark Elf's plan is to play a very aggressive game, using their superior heavy cavalry to dominate the open ground in the centre of the board and destroy any Dogs of War units foolish enough to get in their path. Meanwhile, the Dogs of War will have to try and win by scoring as many points as they can from objectives and holding on as long as they can before the Dark Elves can break them. The Dogs of War get off to a slow start, with Asarnil the Dragon Lord failing his first order to the Cavalry Brigade. This does, however, permit the cavalry to move at half pace without changing their formation. They ride forward 15 centimetres towards the nearest objective. The Paymaster then orders a brigade of ogres and light infantry to move forwards, and he succeeds on the roll of a 7. He tries a second order to move them again, but fails on a roll of 11. On the right flank, a wizard orders another brigade of ogres and light infantry forwards. As this is his first order of the game, his command is increased to 8 and he passes just. He tries for a second order on the same brigade, but his voice is lost in the sound of marching feet. The order fails. The second wizard then issues an order to the birdmen and succeeds. The birdmen immediately fly in front of the nearest objective next to the tower. As flyers, they cannot claim this objective, but their presence will prevent the Dark Elves from claiming it as well. The wizard then attempts to order the artillery and missile infantry brigade, but his order fails. They do get a half-pace move forwards, which for galloper guns is still 10 centimetres. The Dogs of War General then orders the cavalry brigade to move forwards down the road. A second order to the same brigade allows them to move into contact with the objective adjacent to the road. The General then issues an order to a brigade of pikemen at the rear, and they move forwards along the road as well. A second successful order allows the pikemen to move between the other infantry brigades and cover the cavalry. However, a third order to the same brigade fails, and they move no further. Characters then move positions around the army to best issue commands next turn. In the shooting phase, a wizard successfully casts Voice of Command on the light cavalry occupying the left flank. This allows them to do a full pace move, placing them in contact with the objective by the tower. At the end of the Dogs of War first turn, they have captured 2 objectives and score 2 points. The Dark Elves begin their first turn, with the Sorceress successfully ordering forwards the brigade of 3 Cold One Knights on their left flank. The heavy cavalry move up to within 5 centimetres of their nearest objective, capturing it. On the right flank, the Manticore Hero successfully orders forwards the Dark Riders and then the Harpies. However, his brigade order to the Cold One Knights fails, and they stumble forward 15 centimetres into the ford. The Dark Elf General successfully orders both infantry brigades forwards twice to form a line in front of the wood. The Dark Elf characters then move forwards to take up better positions for next turn, while the Sorceress successfully casts a Dominion spell upon a unit of knights. Volan's Venators are now prevented from charging next turn. In their first turn, the Dark Elves have captured 1 objective and score 1 point. In the Dogs of War second turn, the Paymaster uses his pay wagon to increase his command to a 9. This allows him to successfully order forwards Ogla Khan's wolf boys, who manage to capture a third objective. The Paymaster then orders forward the ogres and accompanying infantry twice to further secure the objective by the road. The Paymaster then orders Volan's Venators to move out and protect the right wing of the army. They successfully receive two orders and take up position adjacent to Perazzo's Lost Legion. The Paymaster then orders the Alcatani Fellowship and Rico's Republican Guard to take up position by the objective. In the centre, Asarnil the Dragonlord again fails his order, and the artillery and missile infantry stumble forward a half-pace move. At the rear of the army, a wizard orders the trailing missile infantry to move up in support. Dutch Schaefer then attempts to order the birdmen forwards, but they fail to understand his thick accent. After the orders phase, characters are repositioned around the army. On the right wing and left wing, units have advanced in good order. However, the failure of commands in the centre have left the flanking units with little support from the rest of the army. In the magic phase, a wizard once again successfully casts Voice of Command, this time upon the birdmen. They fly directly behind the Dark Elf Cold One Brigade on the right flank. However, the birdmen's shooting attacks fail to penetrate the Dark Elves' armour. At the end of their second turn, the Dogs of War now successfully control three objectives. This gives them a healthy lead in points and will force the Dark Elves to attack. In the Dark Elves' second turn, the Manticore hero orders forwards the Dark Riders towards the objective claimed by the Wolf Boys. However, his order to the Cold One Brigade fails, and they only stumble forward a half-paced move. In the centre, the Sorceress orders forward a brigade of infantry from the wood, bringing the Wolf Boys into repeater crossbow range. The Dark Elf General orders some Harpies out on the extreme left flank, taking cover behind a hill. The General then orders a string of commands to the Cold One Knights on the left flank. The orders succeed, and Volan's Venators find themselves receiving a Dark Elf Cold One charge to their flank. A second unit of Cold Ones charges the Venators in the front, whilst the third unit falls back to claim the objective. The General then orders forwards a second infantry brigade out of the wood to form a coherent battle line in the centre. And the Dark Elf characters then reposition themselves around the army. The Sorceress manages to cast a Dominion spell on the Birdmen, preventing them from charging next turn. And then the Dark Elf infantry unload the full force of their repeater crossbows into Ogla Khan's Wolf Boys. The Wolf Boys suffer 7 hits after saves, they lose 2 stands and are then driven back. The drive-back roll very nearly routs the Wolf Boys, but they somehow survive and swear revenge. In the combat phase, the devastating charge of the Cold One Knights crashes into the Venators. The Venators take 16 hits, but they're so drunk they can't feel the pain, and succeed in all but 5 saves. The Venators and Perazzo's Lost Legion then fight back and score 2 hits on the Cold Ones. The pikemen add 1 supporting stand to the combat total, which brings them up to 3. This means the Dogs of War units have lost the combat by 2 points, and as they have 2 units fighting, they retreat 1 centimetre. The Venators have sustained 5 hits, and that's enough to remove 1 stand and carry 2 hits over. As the surviving stands are only touching Cold Ones to their front, they retreat 1 centimetre backwards. The Cold Ones then elect to pursue and move directly forwards back into contact with the Venators, lapping round the rear with 1 stand. The pursuit attacks are especially deadly and the Venators are wiped out. However, they do manage to bring down a stand of Cold Ones as they go. The Dogs of War once again lose combat by 2 points, so the pikemen have to retreat 1 centimetre, as there were 2 units on the losing side. The unwounded Cold Ones elect to pursue the pikemen, whilst the damaged Cold Ones fall back in good order. As each side has fought 2 rounds of combat, the engagement now ends for this turn. and further combat rounds will be fought in the Dogs of War turn. At the end of their second turn, the Dark Elves still only control a single objective. However, they have drawn first blood by wiping out Volin's Venators and severely damaging the Wolf Boys. The Dark Elves know they must get their aggressive units on the right flank moving if they stand any chance of dislodging the Dogs of War from their early lead. Meanwhile, the Dogs of War will have to come up with a plan to prevent six units of Cold One Knights from tearing their army apart. The Dogs of War begin their third turn quite poorly, with once again Asarnil the Dragon Lord failing his orders. The ogres and their accompanying infantry only get a half-pace move and desperately try to cover both their flanks against the Cold One aggression. The Galloper guns and their accompanying missile infantry are ordered forwards to bring the Dark Elf infantry within range, with a unit of light cavalry moving up to protect their flank. More infantry brigades are moved up in the centre and on the left to secure the objective by the tower. The characters then reposition themselves around the Dogs of War army. In the magic phase, the wizards fail to cast the spell required to move a unit back up to claim the third objective. The Galloper guns then begin their bombardment of the Dark Elf infantry. A stand of crossbowmen is destroyed, and both they and their supporting infantry are driven back and confused. Meanwhile, the birdmen once again shoot at the Cold One Knights, but fail to cause any damage. In the combat phase, Perazzo's Lost Legion are killed off by the Cold One Knights. However, they do die slowly enough to make the Cold Ones think twice about advancing into the waiting ogres. Instead, the Cold Ones elect to fall back to recover their hits and set up a flank charge next turn. The failure of the Dogs of War units to recapture the third objective this turn has cost them valuable points. The open ground between the two armies is now a no man's land, with the Dogs of War unwilling to commit their infantry forwards, whilst the threat of Cold One Knights waiting in the wings is still apparent. And equally, the Dark Elves don't wish to advance their own infantry forwards without cavalry support. At the start of Dark Elf turn 3, the Cold One Knights use their initiative to charge the flank of the ogres and accompanying swordsmen. A unit of harpies then homes back towards the Dark Elf general. The manticore hero tries to issue an order to the second unit of harpies but fails, but they have sufficient move just to turn around. The sorceress then successfully orders the dark riders forward to capture the outstanding objective. With the general ordering the unit of harpies which homed back to fly behind the birdmen who are threatening the Cold One Knights. The Dark Elf general then issues a string of orders to a unit of Cold One Knights, allowing them to move around the flank of the engaged ogres and charge them. He then further orders up the non-confused Dark Elf infantry brigades to form a solid line. Finally, he issues another order to the distant Cold One Knight Brigade. The order fails, but the knights are allowed to move forward half-pace once more. The Manticore hero then flies across the battlefield to join the combat between Cold One Knights and ogres. The other Dark Elf characters then move around the battlefield. We then move to the shooting phase, with the sorceress once again successfully casting her Dominion spell, this time targeting the remaining knight unit on the Dogs of War left flank. The Dark Elf shooting fails to remove the remaining stand of Ogre Khan's Wolf Boys. And then in the combat phase, the Dark Elves execute their pincer movement on the stranded ogres. The ogres and human infantry supporting them suffer heavy losses, and over two rounds of combat are wiped out. The Cold One Knights then both elect to fall back in good order to recover their hits, and also to contest the objective, and threaten the pikemen both forth and aft. At the end of their third turn, the Dark Elves now control two objectives and contest a third, and they've also removed four Dogs of War units from the field, for no losses of their own. Dogs of War Turn 4 begins with Oglekan's wolf boys using their initiative to evade. They evade away from the Dark Riders, who are within 20 centimeters, but as they are light cavalry, they get to evade in any direction, so move directly onto the objective. The Birdmen then make a homeback move of 20 centimeters, which allows them to keep imposing a command penalty on the Cold One Knights. The Dogs of War army is still being threatened by two units of Cold One Knights on their right flank. To counter this, the missile unit brigades at the rear of the army are ordered to turn 90 degrees and target the nearest unit of Cold Ones. The artillery brigade is then given an order to move into a strange formation, allowing missile infantry to target the Dark Riders and a Cold One unit, whilst the cannon's fire is all focused on a separate Cold One unit. On the left flank, the light cavalry is ordered off the hill, but the order fails, so it can only move half pace. However, the general does manage to order up an infantry brigade and the knights to secure the objective. The shooting phase begins with a wizard throwing a ball of flame into the Dark Riders, which is dispelled by the sorceress. A unit of Tilean crossbowmen take aim at the Dark Riders and score 3 hits.
Bada bop boom pow!
The Dark Riders lose a stand and are driven back into the crossbowmen. Both units are confused. The Birdmen target the Harpies with their crossbows and drive them off the board. The Galloper Guns take aim at the Cold One Knights and destroy 2 stands from the unit. The surviving stand is driven far away from the objective they were contesting. The other missile units are less successful and only drive back the other Cold One Knights a single centimetre. The turn now ends with the Dogs of War back in control of 2 objectives. Turn 4 is make or break time for the Dark Elves, as the Dogs of War are only a single point away from winning the game. However, if the Dark Elves can break the Dogs of War this turn, and retain control of 2 objectives, they will win. The turn begins with a unit of Cold One Knights using their initiative to charge a unit of pikemen in the rear. The Dark Elf General successfully orders forward the remaining Cold One Brigade on the right flank. 2 units crash into an exposed unit of crossbowmen, and a 3rd unit ploughs into the light cavalry, catching them in the flank. The Manticore hero lends his weight to the fight against the pikemen on the left flank, and over 2 rounds of combat, the Alcatani Fellowship are destroyed. However, Rico's Republican Guard survive. In the centre, the Cold One Knights destroy a unit of crossbowmen and then advance into the Galloper Guns, killing both artillery units. On the right flank, the Cold One Knights easily destroy the light cavalry, and then choose to advance into the defended ogres on the hill. However, the ogres and their supporting infantry prove to be too tough a nut to crack, and the cavalry is forced to retreat, leaving the objective firmly in the possession of the Dogs of War. As a result, the Dark Elves have lost their chance to win the game, as they failed to break the Dogs of War this turn. At the start of their 5th turn, the Dogs of War know that they don't actually have to take any actions in order to win the game this turn, as they have an objective secure, which will score them 1 point and bring their total up to 10. However, there is an old Tilean proverb, "Cowards die in shame." An all-out charge is declared on the Cold One Knights. If the Cold Ones can somehow win this combat, then they may well break the Dogs of War this turn anyway, and the game will be a draw. To hedge their bets, the Dogs of War move up what remaining units they have to try and claim a second objective. They then reposition all their remaining missile troops to target the Cold One Knights and drive them off this objective. In the shooting phase, the Cold One Knights come under a withering hail of crossbow bolts, but their armour holds and they end up still within 5 centimetres of the objective, contesting it. However, in close combat, the brave knights, assisted by the Dragon Lord, succeed in pushing the Cold One Knights back into the pikemen, and they are all cut down. With this final action, the Dogs of War score enough victory points to win the game.